week one. And now, because of coronavirus, church is online and I get to watch it in the Philippines. I am one of the missionaries that the World Impact Team is supporting, so I'm currently in the Philippines videoing this for you guys. And I just really wanted to thank you for your prayers and the support that you've all offered us, offered me, but most importantly, Sophie. As you are probably aware, because of the church email that went out, Sophie is in hospital. She is doing a lot better, but it's definitely been a very interesting experience with the coronavirus and how simple public hospitals in the Philippines are. It's actually the only hospital that we could get her into after calling 42 hospitals. So it's been a very rough time for us here, but it's also been such a blessing to see God working in this and everyone coming together as a community to support her. I also just wanted to talk a little bit about what's been happening here in the ministry that we're volunteering at. So most of the things that Kim offers have had to be stopped. But we've started running these camps called Youth Lab. And so we've had 165 students attend these camps. And out of 165 students, we've had 105 be baptized and give their lives to Christ for the very first time. It's been such an awesome experience, and it's been such a blessing. And I just thank you all for your support and continued prayer. Through us being here and through this time. I just hope that you continue to pray for me and Sophie and just pray that she has a fast recovery and that she will be out of hospital back with you soon. Thank you so much, guys.
Welcome back to Sydenham Baptist Church. It is so great to be able to still meet together in this way. We're about to sing a song called The Lion and the Lamb, and I love particularly the lyrics in the bridge for this song. It says, "Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And there is no one who can stop our God." It's just so powerful that even during this time, even during a global pandemic, that we're still able to meet as a church. And that's so worth praising our God for. So let's sing together, The Lion and the Lamb.
Fighting. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion.
God, every knee will bow before you because you are the Lord Almighty. We love you, God, and we praise you for who you are.
To be overcome.
Be still and know that I am God. What wonderful words that were spoken by Jesus. I love this series of Selah. It is so appropriate for this season of restrictions, fears, illness, and isolation. It would be so easy for us to be disheartened or depressed. But I want to challenge you to choose to look at the positives. More time to be still, to spend time with God and to deepen our relationships with Him. Also more time to deepen our relationship with other people. Our life group has changed from meeting fortnightly to now meeting via Zoom weekly for study, fortnightly for prayer, and then once a month getting together to have a social time together. And frequently contacting one another to share praise points, prayer points, to encourage one another via WhatsApp. Many people in our group are saying that our relationships have grown during this time. It's been a wonderful thing. Now that's a big plug for life groups. And if you're not in a life group, I'm afraid you're missing out. And I really encourage you to contact Christine Aldiev, the ministry team leader for life groups, or our church office, and they'll try and put you into a group so that you can experience those benefits as well. Now let us come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the opportunities to spend time with you, to listen and to be led, to slow down and be still and know that you are God. Thank you that you are a God who loves us, cares for us, and wants the best for us. Thank you that we can talk to you and bring you our cares and concerns, that you listen and answer our prayers. We pray for those who are sick, isolated, and for those who are in uncertain employment situations. We pray for those who are mourning and those who are missing family and friends due to the current restrictions. We pray for the medical and emergency workers who are placing themselves in dangerous situations, and for the scientists who are seeking a vaccine. We pray too for our political leaders and decision makers that they will be making the best possible decisions. Thank you for providing for us and for the faithful givers who enable the ministries of our church to continue. And Father, as we bring our tithes and offerings to you, please accept them as a token of our thanks for your provision for us. Thank you, Father God. Amen. One of the great things that we can do as a church is to join together and to take communion. Jesus met with his disciples, his fellow workers for God, in the upper room. It is wonderful that we can continue this practice 2,000 years later, even in stage 4 lockdown. We can remember and celebrate what God has done for us. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 26, we read that Jesus, holding up the bread, said, "This is my body." We are reminded that God became flesh in the form of Jesus. He dwelt among us, showing us how to live, how to love, how to teach, and how to encourage. This was needed due to God's intention for mankind being lost due to our sin. Christ came as a perfect man to make a new humanity. Let us take this bread as we accept being part of this new humanity. Then in verse 28, we read that Jesus, holding up the cup, said, "This is my blood." Jesus went through a humiliating and painful death that speaks loudly of the love of God for his people. In Jesus' death, he bore our sins so that we can be set free. Let us drink this cup together as we accept the forgiveness that Jesus provides. Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that we have been able to celebrate and remember what you have done for us. But help us to remember that Christ didn't only shed his blood for us, it was for the world. As we have shared this communion together, help us to remember that we have a message of salvation that the world needs to hear and receive. Please help us to live lives that honour the enormous sacrifice that was made. Amen. Thank you for sharing with me. And now we have the privilege of hearing God's message that is brought to us by Pastor Georgie.
Good morning, church, and welcome. What a privilege it is to be here this morning to share with you what God has been showing me. So I hope that you've enjoyed our Selah series so far, a series that has helped us to pause, to ponder, and practice. In the first week, we bravely had Mel share with us about her addiction to busyness. She passionately shares how the practice of silence and solitude changed her spiritual life. Then we had James. James taught us on the importance of Sabbath. Sabbath is a gift given to us by God, a day in which we can simply stop, we can cease from striving and just enjoy and delight in what God's given us. Last week, Joe spoke to us about simplicity and the importance of living a simple life. She discussed how changing our inner reality is the first step to simplicity, that living a life lightly and freely can help us to create a space where we can connect with God and keep Him first in our life. Have you decluttered anything in your life this week, or have you let go of any habits that may be holding you down? Maybe you can discuss some of these things or some of the practices or the habits that we've been learning about in your life group this week. So today I will be sharing with you on the last spiritual discipline or the last spiritual habit of slowing. Slowing is something that you do intentionally. Slowing down of your mind, your body, and your spirit to help us match the pace of Jesus. It's a habit that we do as a whole person, a habit of mind and body that helps us to present ourselves before God so that His Holy Spirit can do a deep work within us. And then we will be looking at how Jesus practiced this spiritual discipline and how He displayed a lifestyle of slowing. But before we do all that, I'd like us just to, you guessed it, slow down. And if you could join me in prayer. Father God, we come before You this morning and we thank You so much for the privilege to be in Your house, the privilege to share Your word with Your people. Thank You, Father God, for today. I just ask that You just fill me with Your Holy Spirit and that You open our hearts to what You're doing, Father God, that You help me this morning to share on what You've been teaching me on a life of slowing, that You would help all of us to be able to incorporate all the disciplines that we have learned in our life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So as humans, we are made in the image of God. We are made for relationship with God and also for the worship of God. We live in a body, we have a soul, and we have a spirit. The soul part of us is made up of our will, our mind, and our emotions. And our spirit, that's the part of us that is eternal. When we read in Genesis 1:27, we are told that God created mankind in His image. I always thought that this had to do with, you know, the physical features like the color of your hair or your eyes or your gender of male and female. But I came to realize that being created in God's image involves so much more. We are created in God's image through our body, through our soul, through our spirit. And the knowledge that we are created this way has really helped me. It's really helped me to understand God more and also to love Him more. But there's a great difference between us and God. God is almighty. God is supreme. He is infallible. He's sinless. He's all powerful. God is amazing. But me and us, not so much. We are told in Corinthians 2:5 that we still live in a body. And this body that we live in is just an earthly tent. It's temporary. But the spirit part of us, it comes alive and it becomes eternal when we start to believe in Jesus Christ and that we become born again. In John 3:5, Jesus tells us that, "Very truly I tell you that no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born again of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit." When we are born again in Christ, the Bible tells us that we become a new creation, and our spirit, it's renewed. But our flesh, our old nature, our old patterns of behavior and thinking, they're not renewed. And this is where the battle begins. The battle begins between the flesh, our old attitudes, and our new regenerated spirit. In Galatians 5:17, we are told that the sinful nature that we have, it wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the spirit wants. And the spirit gives us desires that are opposite to the sinful nature. These two forces are constantly fighting each other. So the situation that I find myself still being in the flesh is that I want to slow down. I want to slow down my pace of life. I want to do less. I want to spend more time with God. But my flesh, it fights back. It fights back with an overload of activities, responsibilities that ultimately just speed up my pace of life. Do you feel the same? Do you think you can relate? And what can we do about it? Well, we can start looking at our lifestyle. So the definition of lifestyle is this: a way in which a person lives based on his or her beliefs, priorities, and principles that guide that person's life. Our lifestyle dictates the choices that we make and the pace of our life. Do you think that maybe given that we're flesh and spirit, there could be two different types of lifestyles that we could live? A spirit one, which is Christ-centered and other-focused. Or a flesh one, which is self-centered and inward, selfish-focused. So I had to ask myself, what is my lifestyle filled with? Is it Christ-centered or is it self-centered? To answer this question, I must confess that my lifestyle is mostly and sometimes filled with endless activities, commitments like career, family, ministry, hobbies, entertainment, God, also just a lot of doing. I found myself having to ask myself, do I make choices that are pleasing to the spirit and inducive to slowing down? Or do I make choices that are just pleasing to my flesh? The answer is, well, first, I kind of must know what my purpose is. Why am I doing all of this for? Well, one of the greatest commandments that God gave us is to love God and to love others. In Mark 12:30-31, we are told that you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and all your strength. And the second command is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these. So this is the charge, to love God and to love others. Simple, right? But of course, it's not. Loving God and loving others requires time. It requires slowing. It requires self-sacrifice and giving. It's the opposite of what I feel like doing. It's the opposite of what society tells us that is normal. And how can I love others if I am distracted? Distracted by my own thoughts, distracted by my own mind, distracted by my desires, and living my life in warp speed? The answer is, I cannot. Romans 8:6 tells us that the mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the spirit is life and peace. I want this lifestyle of slowing, this lifestyle of life and peace. And if I want this, I decided that I must make intentional choices to follow a life that's filled with the Holy Spirit, a life that is not in a hurry, but intentionally slow, because the spirit life is not in a hurry, but is intentionally slow. Can you say that your lifestyle is spiritually focused or is it flesh driven? What would your ideal lifestyle look like? Are there things distracting you from what God is wanting you to prioritize in your life? I'm not sure. But where do we go through? Where do we go from here? Well, the next thing we're going to look at is Jesus's lifestyle. Jesus is our ultimate example. Ultimately, we want to live like Jesus. We want to follow him. We want to be his disciples. Our motto of focus, follow Jesus, or becoming committed disciples of Jesus. And to do this, I thought, let's look at how he lived his life. Jesus' own life was never in a hurry. He was open to people and always open to interruptions. He was not distracted by his own feelings or his own desires or his own goals, but he pursued passionately the will of the Father. This was most evident when we see Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he asks God to take away the cup of suffering from him. But ultimately, what did Jesus do? He chose the will of the Father. He chose death and suffering. He chose love and sacrifice. Another very beautiful story that reminds me of the importance of spending time with God is found in Matthew 14. This is a story again about Jesus, where Jesus just finds out that John the Baptist has been beheaded. And Jesus wants to be alone. He wants to retire to a private place. He wants to rest. He wants to stop and he wants to grieve. But the crowds that are around him, they follow him. And once again, Jesus is gracious and he is compassionate to them. And even though he is hurting and he's tired at this point, he has compassion on the crowd and heals some of the sick among them. Then he performs the miracle of feeding the 5,000, and the scripture tells us that immediately Jesus tells his disciples to get into a boat and to go on the other side of the lake while he will dismiss the crowd. After he dismisses the crowd, he himself went up to the mountainside by himself to pray alone. Once again, we see Jesus leave the crowd when there was still work to be done. But Jesus knew that he needed to take care of something that was much more important. He needed to rest. He needed to slow down. He needed to grieve. He needed to grieve the loss of John the Baptist. He needed to spend time with God and fall into his arms and maybe even just cry his eyes out. Because Jesus, while though he was God, he could have gone around and fixed everyone else's problem. But Jesus was also human, and he needed to slow down. He needed rest, and he needed to spend time with God. So if Jesus needed these things, if he needed to grieve and rest, how much more do we need to set boundaries in our lives when we're going through a difficult time, like we are now in this pandemic? Or just so that our lives can slow down, so that we can focus on the well-being of our souls. Throughout the Gospels, we also see that Jesus spent time with the ones that he loved. He made spending times with loved ones another priority. You could see him traveling with his disciples. They ministered together. They lived together. They delivered and drove out demons together. But Jesus also had time for fun. He did things like go to a wedding. He visited his mum and his brothers. He hung out with Lazarus and Mary and Martha. He understood the importance of spending time with those he also loved. And he modeled this while he was on earth. We can say that Jesus's lifestyle was other people focused, was love focused. So what does this say about me? What does my lifestyle look like? Well, I can be honest with you and say that on reflection, I can tell you honestly that I am not always like Jesus. I fail time and time again. I'm prone to follow my flesh and fulfill my own plans, which often includes a life of hurry and busyness. This has been especially true for me in this time of lockdown. I don't know if this is the same case for you, but I know that a lot of us in this lockdown, we are now either working from home, schooling from home, we've suddenly become teachers to our children, and our own families have become busier than ever. I know that we can be working a lot of extra hours. We're all Zooming from home, like Gary said before, even for socializing or for church or for work. Some days I feel like I have so many different roles to perform that at the end of the day, I'm utterly exhausted. You know, the roles like mum, wife, teacher, student, cook. So I too hurry along through my day, ticking my endless to-do list. And if I'm not hurrying, I'm distracted. Distracted by my own workload or by the constant bad news about corona on TV, or distracted by my phone or by social media. And I found that consequently, I was giving God and people only my leftovers. A time where I was already exhausted by my day and I was not acting very lovingly. So I remember one morning when I was running late, getting the kids ready off to school, I was making breakfast and Alicia stops me and she says, "Mum, have you spent any time with God this morning?" And I stopped packing lunches and I looked at her and said, "Ali, why do you ask?" And then she stops and looks at me and says, "Mum, you're a much nicer mum when you do." So the honesty of kids, hey? This hit me like a ton of bricks. If my kids were seeing that I'm frazzled, that I'm, you know, that I'm in a hurry all the time and it's affecting them, it must be serious. And then I realized I'd forgotten what was most important. What was most important was to love God and to love others. I'd forgotten my purpose. So at this stage, I decided I had a choice to make. I had to choose whether I was going to continue living this life of the flesh that's hurried and unloving, or if I'm going to purposely try to live a life of the Spirit. But then what does a life of the Spirit look like? Well, you guessed it. It looks like slowing down. Slowing down my pace of life. Slowing down for loving union. For loving union with God. For silence and solitude. For practicing Sabbath. Intentionally getting rid of my distractions. Getting rid of Netflix or TV time or my phone. So that I can prioritize what's really important. So I can prioritize spending time with God. So I can engage in worship or just listen to music. That I can pray regularly and making reading God's word a priority. All of these disciplines that I'm talking about are disciplines that are meant to feed your spirit, to feed your inner man. They're not fleshly disciplines. Only then can I find that I am strong enough to have control over my flesh and to have control over my desires and my urges when I'm spending time with God and when I'm in the Spirit. And Galatians 5:16 actually tells us this. It says this, "So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves." And then in verse 22, it tells us the kind of fruits that the Holy Spirit will produce in our life when we let him have control. It says that the Spirit produces these kind of fruits in our lives. It produces love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's no law against these things because those who belong to Jesus Christ have nailed their passions and their desires and their sinful nature to his cross and has crucified them there. Since we live by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. So this is something that I so want to do. I'd want so badly to live a lifestyle that is governed by the fruits of the Spirit, to slow down my mind, to slow down my body, and to intentionally invite the Holy Spirit into my day. Doing this helps me to produce the fruits of the Spirit. I must confess to you that my Alicia's observations of my behavior was spot on. When I don't intentionally slow down, when I don't spend time with God in the morning, or if I don't start my day slowly, inviting God into my space, I'm not a very nice person. This is because I'm operating out of my flesh, and my flesh is not always nice. It can be cranky. It can be selfish, especially when I haven't had my morning coffee. But if I invite the Holy Spirit and I ask God to be in control of me, if I slow down, if I intentionally practice silence and solitude, and like I said before, listen to worship music and start my day slowly, then I can produce those fruits that I want. I can be loving and kind to my kids. I can have joy and peace throughout my day. And God gives me that victory that I so crave that is over my flesh. But this only happens when I first pause and then I connect with Him. So this is kind of my prayer for all of us, that we would all be able to just slow down, to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, to follow a lifestyle that is unhurried, that is slow, a lifestyle where we can incorporate the habits that we have learnt, where we can incorporate Sabbath, where we can incorporate silence and solitude. But now comes the practice part. This is something that I have been practicing. It's called breath prayers. And these breath prayers, they help me to slow down and focus on God. So I want you to try this simple exercise with me this week. As you move through your day and you start to feel hurried or you start to feel anxious, pay attention to the sensation of your body. Pay attention to the stress and how it makes you feel. See how it inhibits your ability to be present in love. When you feel this way, take a pause. Stop. Grab a cup of coffee and simply breathe in. Breathe in God's presence and breathe out maybe gratitude. And if you're like me and you have a problem with your flesh, and let's face it, I'm guessing a lot of us do, maybe while you're praying, ask God to help you to display the fruits of the Spirit. Simply say as often, like I often say, while I'm having my coffee or doing the breath prayers, I'm saying, help me, help me, help me, Jesus. Help me to be nice. Help me to be good to the kids. Help me to be loving to David. It's just a simple exercise to help us slow our day down, to help us to get our mind focused back on God when we're feeling rushed or we're feeling stressed by the responsibilities that we have in our day. So this is the challenge that I want to leave you with. What kind of lifestyle are you living? Is your lifestyle spiritual? Is it Christ-centered? Is it focused on others? Is it loving? Is it helping you to stay connected with God in silence and solitude? Are you practicing Sabbath? Are you slowing down in love so you can be loving towards others? Can you be present in the moment? Or are you simply living a fast-paced life? If you are, slow down, simplify, so that spending time with God can become a priority in your life. This is what I've been practicing while I've been in quarantine. I've been just practicing slowing down and spending that time with God that has helped me get through. So if you could just join me in praying right now. Father God, we come before you in Jesus' name. And I thank you so much for your goodness towards us. Thank you, Father God, for what we've been learning in this Selah series, that we've been learning habits that can help us slow down, that can help us pause and ponder, that can help us enjoy our life more and connect with you. And we all want that, God. I know that I want that. Help us this week, Father God, to be practicing some of the things that you have been teaching us and that you have been showing us. Thank you for the privilege of sharing with everyone this morning. And thank you for speaking through me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, thank you so much, Georgie. What an awesome message. And such a good message to conclude our Selah series as a church. Why don't we continue this time of slowing down in our worship? And yeah, let's praise our God for who he is.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole, empty-handed but not forsaken. I've been set free. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. The sound.
Thank you very much, Campbell and James, for leading us in worship. And thank you, Pastor Georgie. That was a wonderful first sermon. I look forward, and I'm sure all of us at Sydenham are looking forward to hearing many more. Well done. Well, we are coming to a very special time of the year, Father's Day, something to celebrate. But we fathers, there are only many pairs of socks and handkerchiefs that we can use. Here comes a wonderful possibility of what you could get for your father for Father's Day.
Father's Day is fast approaching. This jerry can gift card represents 20 litres of fuel. It comes with a $50 donation and puts us in the air for 20 minutes. In the remote places in which we serve, that's enough time to save a life. In the past 5 years, people all across Australia have been giving these gift cards to the dad in their life for Father's Day. We've been fueled for around 3,500 hours as a result. This year, we're doing it again, and we've got something exciting to show you.
Introducing this little guy, a 10-litre jerry can of fuel. A donation of $25 puts us in the air for 10 minutes. You'd be amazed at what a math plane can do in that time. But there's more.
Introducing the Kids Colouring In Jerry Can. This card comes with a $10 donation and provides math with around 4 litres of fuel. It's a great gift for Dad, and you can colour it in.
Each card is packed full of Dad jokes guaranteed to make him laugh and you cringe. You can make your donation and receive your card by jumping online to maf.org.au/Father's Day or by making your donation at church today. Thanks for keeping us in the air.
Well, that is a very good suggestion. It's a present that keeps giving. Well, thank you for joining with us this morning. It's been a wonderful time of praising our Lord, of worshiping together, of meeting around the Lord's table. Thank you. And please contact our church. If there's anything else we can do, send an email to our church office. Let us know how we can help, how we can support you in prayer. If there are practical things that we can do to help, let us know. And we just pray that God will be with you in this coming week. Amen.